not going to be getting deep into code with this. The main reason I think you'll see once I get into it is there's so much to cover with autonomous navigation, especially with the CUDA deep neural networks. So, and there's so many different libraries. So I want to, in order to be able to talk briefly about each one, if I were to dive deep into any particular one of them, we can get all of this. So this is an example of a robot you can purchase for a mere $999. It is fully autonomous. You can see, up on the top you've got the 3D depth camera, and then we'll talk more in depth on everything in the middle, but basically the middle is the guts of everything. Then you've got a mobile base on the bottom. Even though that might sound like a lot of money for a fairly limited robot, but if you were to go out and buy each of these parts separately, it would still total to be about the same. So it's actually, for $999, a pretty big deal. I thought about buying this system, but then I realized the practical applications for something like this isn't quite in the space of what I'm wanting to get into. While it would be a neat learning exercise, and I'm sure I'd learn a lot from buying something like this, you can, without spending that amount of money, you can go and learn, everything in the middle without spending any money. It's all free libraries that you can just download. The 3D depth camera and the mobile base, of course, if you want to experiment, you'll have to go and buy that yourself. So if I were to break this robot down into its basic parts, at the top, whenever we're talking about autonomous robots, you'll notice there's no cords to it. So it's autonomous means it's completely off on its own. It's running under its AI, so it's not remotely operated with the joystick or anything like that. But if you look at what's the bare minimum of what makes up an autonomous robot, it falls into these three spots. You have to have at the top, you have to have some sort of a sensor. In this case, it's a 3D depth camera, so you'll have some kind of visual input, or it could just be as artificial intelligence, you know, be able to know where to go. And then it's always going to have the mobile component. Some optional add-ons, and this one actually has a couple of optional add-ons. It can have audio sensory, which in this case, speech recognition, that's a huge area that you can use to stuff from the neural networks. It also has a speaker, that's that thing in the middle, so it can actually interface, it has a user interface, so it can receive audio and it can actually speak back to you. It doesn't have this, but it could also have some kind of other ways to interact with its environment, like it can have some robotic arms. Whenever we're talking about these different components that are on a robot, what we're really interested in talking about isn't specifically so much the hardware that's involved, but as software developers, we're really interested in all of the connections that go from each of those input-output devices back to the CPU or the GPU. So that could be a really long talk if we were just to cover, each one of these arrows. So we're going to go down to the bare minimum, once again, of autonomous navigation just to keep the talk short, which means we're going to exclude any discussions about robotic arms. I'm going to keep this pretty short so we can have the demo. You guys can feel free to use the Vibe if you're interested in that. Also, if any of you are interested in having discussions about some of these things I'm asking out, it's not that I'm not interested in talking about them, I'm just trying to keep this talking part of this session down to the end. We're also not going to be talking about the outputs, speech patterns, and the voice recognition. Another interesting area would be talking about how to create a really cute robot. I know that sounds like I'm just trying to be funny, but the reality is you saw, you know, this guy moving down the road towards your house, you might just get up the shotgun. So in this case, we're not going to be talking about that, but, you know, it's something that's worth, I find those types of discussions about the social interaction with artificial intelligence robots or androids, you know, I can talk all night with you about that. But we won't be getting into complex stuff is in the middle with the brain. You can see a big list of things that this robot supports. There's other libraries besides this, but these are some of the most common ones, and that's why I selected this as just kind of a good beginner-level autonomous robot to facilitate the discussion. I just realized I totally forgot to do something here, which is I forgot to, if you guys don't mind, I'd like to go around the room and have each of you just give me your name and tell me something random about yourself. With my master's degree, I started out specializing in artificial intelligence, and I did do parallel courses, but I ended up going into 3D graphics, specifically with ray tracing. So for me, there was actually a practical application that I entered into later where it sort of combines all of these. So that's why I'm excited about it.
I'm Bob
Laskowski,
computer science and student at Augsburg College. I'm with my friend Tony Akers.
Okay, so my name is Vlad. I'm a grad student here in this department, and I'm doing a neutrino physics experiment. And actually, we're using Kafka library to distinguish different events in our detector. So I'm also interested in autonomous navigation. Yeah, probably a huge for my future job. So everything sounds really interesting.
I'm Satish, I work with Vlad.
Alright, the whole team.
Yeah. I'm Mariana, and I'm a postdoc at the physics department, again working with the high energy physics in the department. So, doing experimental physics, and my interests are basically high performance image processing.
Okay.
So that we can and applications and how to do the GPU coding in GPU and how to make it work more efficiently.
Yeah. We got a lot of super smart people.
I'm Graham. I've worked for physics department for a long time, but now with the Supercomputing Institute, and there's some questions going by about machine learning and
working
a lot. Yeah, it's CUDA, so I have a general interest.
Now, what I should say too is when I mentioned that autonomous navigation really isn't my area of expertise. Originally, Kirk and I were trying to get Jonathan from NVIDIA, who he's the true expert on this stuff. What I will do is after the meeting is I'll send out his information. So if any of you do have any questions specific around the things that I'm going to talk about at a very high level, he would be able to help you out.
So I looked at your previous tutorials, and it seems that you have quite a few Ask Me apps that would be of great interest to us.
Okay.
Is it possible to get the same people to do similar things?
Yeah, I know. So in September, Tony Scudiero from NVIDIA will be coming back. So there's some pretty regular attenders that will be back, and even if the topic is slightly different, I'm sure it'll come back to similar discussions that we've been having. So is there any in particular, like in the area of ray tracing, or what were the ones that you were?
The CUDA applications and how.
Yeah, Tony did a CUDA 101 as well.
Yeah,
so we're probably going to. I don't know if there's been a meeting where we haven't talked about CUDA. We tend to be pretty CUDA focused. Not to say that if you're not in CUDA, that we're in the right company. Jump up.
back up to the...
We're just going around the room with your name. Tell us something random.
Oh,
my name is Thanks.
Right now, I'm an intern at Crate, working on HPC, on the application scene. And then next semester, I'm going to start graduate school in IPW Madison. I might have to do something with this. It's going to be
okay.
In the area of computer vision and
sure.
Computational photography. So, I'm very interested
in awesome.
This kind of
thing. Now, do you guys know each other from Crate? No? Okay.
No.
Maybe you'll run into each other. Okay, and then in the back, my wife Karen, who's recording this, and my other son Kyle. Here is one of my sons, Colin, and there's, I don't know if he's playing Pokemon Go there, but the 18-year-old son is there as well. Did you want to say anything, Karen?
Thanks.
Okay, we're just recording. All right. Moving on. So, okay, we're going to focus on those two blue arrows, but really what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go down the list and just at a high level describe what each one of these are. So Google TensorFlow is actually, it's the newer library. Google originally did Piano and then they went to TensorFlow. You probably can't read that, so I'll just real quick. It's an open source software library for numerical computation using data flow graphs. So the nodes in the graph represent mathematical operations, and while the graph edges represent the multidimensional data arrays, which are called tensors, are communicated between them. I'm not going to read this whole thing, but I think you can see how that would naturally fit with neural networks. The next one, sort of a one-off, but the robot operating system is a collection of software frameworks for robot software development, providing operating system-like functionality on a heterogeneous computer cluster. So this is not a high-performance computing operating system, but it's something that's very practical and very widely used for robots. And then we start getting into more of the deep learning model stuff. Torch is a scientific computing framework with wide support for machine learning algorithms that puts GPUs first. It's easy to use and efficient thanks to an easy and fast scripting language, Lua, JIT, and an underlying C Lua implementation. Piano is a Python library that allows you to define, optimize, and evaluate mathematical expressions involving multidimensional arrays efficiently. There's more, a lot more to it than that, but all of these are just different libraries that you can use. Cafe, very widely used. It's a deep learning framework made with expression speed and modularity in mind. It is developed by the Berkeley Vision Learning Center and by community contributors. And then, of course, CUDA, plus the CUDA Deep Neural Networks. This library is a GPU-accelerated library of primitives for deep neural networks. Provides highly tuned implementations for standard routines such as forward, backward, convolution, pooling, normalization, and activation layers. So it is part of the NVIDIA Deep Learning SDK. So now after I've gone through all that real quickly, you might be wondering, okay, so how do those all work together or not work together? And there's this long list of things that make up the brain of this robot, so it might be sort of confusing. It certainly was confusing for me as well to just look at, what one should I really be digging into? And as I was digging into each one, I started feeling a little bit overwhelmed. But to simplify things, we can right away get rid of those bottom two lines, which is just talking about the hardware specifics of the Tegra K1, which is the GPU. Wi-Fi plus Bluetooth, which just means it can communicate wirelessly. We can also get rid of this robot operating system when we're talking about the brains. It is still part of the brains, but it's not really, like I said, it's not part of the high-performance computing. So really, it's not responsible for the vision stuff so much as it's important for taking, once it knows where it wants to go, you have used the operating system to basically move the wheels or manipulate, you know, the hardware to get it to move around. So if we take that one off the list, we talked just about CUDA and the CUDA deep neural network. The CUDA deep neural network actually works in conjunction with all those other four, and what it does is it accelerates them. So you can be working with any of those other four and, you know, getting, you know, so many, having it run so fast, but then once you add the CUDA deep neural network library on top of it, that'll accelerate it, and sometimes you'll get 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 times faster output from what it can
Are those other packages designed to interface with CUDA, or is there...
Yes, actually, many of them are, I'm trying to think if they all are. I want to say they all are. I have not, I'm, like I said, I'm sort of a high-level guy right now. The expert is out of town. Actually, he moved to South Dakota. So I'm trying to do my best here, but pretty much from what I know, and I can ask him after, later, to verify this, but from what I know, I think they all are... CUDA. There might be one that's not, but if there's one that's not, I'm not sure which one it would be. Right? From
so I'm curious because like TensorFlow or the interfaces to Google's specialized processor or neural networks.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. When
general.
Yeah, when I say CUDA, it's not like it's just GPU. Some of it is CPU parallelization as well. In fact, a lot of them. TensorFlow isn't even just specific to neural networks. You know, TensorFlow does a lot of more. Same thing, I think, with ENO. They're not specifically for neural networks, but they do in ENO. It's like ENO, if you remember the brief description we had up there, it was more about just getting the math to go real fast. So the neural networks aspect of some of these is just part of it, whereas others, I think, Cafe, it's, you know, very much the same. So, and this is just a side note, compiling CUDA-based applications that utilize neural networks with the CUDA deep neural network library does not always make them faster. So, you know, again, it's just almost like an add-on library that makes it faster. Well, that's not always the case. So, for example, Google's Deep Dream computer vision program. And this one I thought was really interesting, too, from a perspective of getting into virtual reality stuff and whatnot. You know, they did... I think something like 10 computations on the left image in order to, basically what it's trying to bring out is patterns that it's finding. It's using neural networks to find graphical patterns, and it creates these really almost psychedelic images as output. And, you know, it's a very interesting application that, you know, it's something that it's not part of this talk, but at some point I'd actually like to look into that to see if there's some way we could do something similar to that in a virtual reality space. But I think from what I was reading on the notes, the Deep Dream does allow you to add the CUDA deep neural network library to it. Basically, you just uncomment some things, but what people were finding was it runs about half as fast. And I think it's probably because it's optimized already for CUDA in a very specific way. So that narrows the list down to just these four. And these are kind of your main four choices. Rather than getting into listing out all the pros and cons of why you'd want to choose one over the other of those four, what I've provided here is a link that gives you... I thought it was a really good pro-con list of comparing those, as well as there's some other libraries available that you could use besides this one. So what I'll do is I'll make this presentation available. You don't have to try to write this out. I'll make this presentation available and send it up to the group so you can grab this link later. So then moving on to autonomous aerial navigation. So... with what I wanted to do, and this is the main reason I wasn't buying this, you know, spending the $999 to get this robot, is what I'm looking to do is get a robot that will autonomously scan an area and create a 3D scene out of it that can then be used in virtual reality. So right now there's lots of different ways, which I'll get into, where you can use different sensors and scanners, even just do at home to take pictures in order to create a very realistic 3D scene and put it into virtual reality. But what I was looking for is some way to simplify the process. The other benefit of going the aerial navigation route is there's a lot of applications for, you know, people that are, say, you know, if you lost your child in the world, you know, you could have a drone go out and try to find them, and then with the artificial intelligence, they could do face recognition and identify the lost child. Same thing if they were lost in the woods, you could send out a drone to scavenge through the woods and find this child. But there's a lot of applications that are really cool in the area of aerial navigation that are, you know, more for the side of saving lives, which I'd like to get into, versus, you know, going out there and just being a military application. So I have a YouTube video here that shows specifically what I'm doing now is I'm narrowing in on, you know, what I'm hoping to use these robots for.
The doors are all locked.
Oh, no.
So all outside doors must lock after 7. Somebody open the door. I sneaked in.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Sorry
you.
About that.
Do you want to go down there and check?
What can I get for an ambulance?
Might have lost sound.
The robot is equipped with an IMU camera and laser scanner with defective mirrors. All computations are performed on board using a 1.6 GHz Atom processor. The robot is able to navigate autonomously in indoor or outdoor, GPS-denied environments. The robot maps its surroundings, localizes in that map, and generates plans in real time to navigate in the environment. A vision-based loop closure module enforces global consistency of the map. An RRT star-based planner provides an anytime planning solution that fits the computational constraints of the robot. This planner also enables online replanning and obstacle avoidance.
So you can see how they sped up their speed.
An LQR Osmo controller with external force
communication
enables reliable autonomous flight in highly constrained environments, such as hallways, doors, and windows. The robot is able to track the high-level plans accurately.
You saw it land there. The other problem with the aerial navigation is these smaller drones
will run out of
battery. This
experiment highlights the performance of localization and control through narrow stairwells and small windows. Absolute height measurements are maintained at all times, and the two-story 3D building structure is reconstructed. Here we show the robot's ability to plan and control through highly constrained structures. such as windows and doors. In the last experiment, we construct a large-scale multi-floor map. The robot is hand-carried to emulate flight, as the length of this experiment is beyond the feasible flight time of the robot. The major building structures, including walls, floors, and windows, are successfully reconstructed in the 3D map.
Example, I want to say that the processing is not done on board, we'd be communicating wirelessly. Think about the challenges you have with aerial navigation is, you have battery life, but then you also have a weight issue, and obviously the more, beefier CPUs and whatnot that you're putting on there, that would reduce its flight time. Closest I can think of where it had onboard artificial intelligence was almost like if it lost the connection, it would be smart enough to turn around and come back. Like it went out of range. But that, I think that's about as sophisticated as it gets. I think the other part is it does still have some rudimentary collision avoidance built in. Yeah, right. So now we're getting into the high performance image processing. No, I don't have a lot of slides for this, so I just basically threw it all on one slide because at this point on it's just a bunch of demos and videos that we're going to watch. So you can see that what we're trying to create as a final output is we want a virtual reality scene, and we want a virtual reality scene that looks photorealistic and gives you the feeling that you're actually there in that other location. So, Colin, this is where you get to show them your demo. Are you ready to show them the lab? All right, let's connect this up.
Worlds that you're talking about. So, do all these virtual reality platforms share like a common how do they,
like a graphics engine?
Like a common way to like describe these virtual worlds. So, for example, I noted that you talked about ROS. ROS is used in conjunction sometimes with this thing called Gazebo, which is like a robotic simulator.
Yeah.
You can define like virtual worlds there, and you have kind of a file pattern. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just because I've worked a little bit of something similar. I knew, but a big challenge was we want like a real virtual world to drive like these cars. These cars that these vehicles we're simulating.
Yeah.
But it's really hard to, get real.
Yeah.
So you don't do like a convention.
The
to define these virtual
worlds.
Yeah,
so at the lower level, at the API level, for the last two decades, it's been pretty strongly either OpenGL or DirectX, and that still holds true in these virtual environments. And that API is a raster-based API. So my area that I'm actually focused on developing is a graphics engine that's a ray tracer for this. So, you know, there are people that are experimenting outside of those boundaries, but I think most of what you'll see in virtual reality today is going to be using either DirectX or OpenGL you might be getting into like WebGL, which is still OpenGL based, but there's lots of different ways to render it in real time, and then there's also lots of different 3D formats of the data. Most of the different 3D formats that, of the data that are out there are easily transposed from one format to another. So regardless of you, if you did it one graphics engine or rendered it or created your 3D world in Maya or 3D Studio Max, it almost doesn't matter because you can just convert it from one to the other.
Okay, so it's pretty easy.
Yeah, it's almost just like pick what your favorite flavor of ice cream is and just go with it. Unless you're talking ray tracing, which is so then you start getting into some weird stuff. Interested after these demos and the videos that I'm going to show that wants to try this out, you're more than welcome to.
Have you come up with a developer version like Oculus? Or is that the commercial
one? This is the commercial one. They also had the developer one. They took a different approach from Oculus. So for Oculus, I bought the WQ1 and the WQ2. For Vive, you couldn't just buy it. You had to be part of an organization where effectively, you need to get voted in order to be able to get the job. So this was actually my first exposure to the buy. It was my purchase notes. But I tried the consumer version of Oculus, and it's also very, pretty much the same specs, very similar experience, so you almost can't. The one advantage with the Vive is it comes with these really neat controllers. Whereas the Oculus, which might be like $100 less or something, it just has the gamepad. In the winter, they'll be coming out with the Oculus Touch, but I think when you buy the Oculus Touch devices, it's the Oculus headset that's probably going to end up costing you more to buy the Oculus bundle. But some other nice things about the Oculus is you see how we have our own pair of headphones here. The Vive does come with like little earbuds, which gets a little bit annoying when you start sharing it with other people. So that's why we bought that external headphone. Whereas the Oculus does have its built-in headphones. There's pros and cons. Intro. So what I was saying is the play intro. this is one of the challenges with the Vive is you obviously have these barriers, and you can't see the grids, but when he comes up to a wall, it shows the grids so that he doesn't run into a wall or step off the step. So what they do when you're limited and you need to go forward is it gives you the ability to teleport around in the space, but we think we have these problems with the teleporting.
Welcome to the Aperture Science Sub-Universe Exploration Center. Please move forward. This is the Aperture Science space-mounted portal sphere. It is your gateway to a vast continuum of undiscovered worlds.
So this Vesper part was created with taking a bunch of 3D photographs and doing a bunch of number crunching on it and creating some very cool effects and scene. The developer that took the pictures, he was just originally on vacation in Iceland, and he just decided, well, let's see what happens. And the results are really impressive. So even here, you can see there's the green areas and the red areas, so certain green spots are where they took the different photographs, whereas the red areas, you're limited to the areas that you can go, but you do get that sense of being able to explore around, and when you're wearing it, you really do feel like you're actually there. So in this demo, they had like four different places around the world that they created. Very cool. It's
Balloons. Why isn't it coming off?
Since they just released it, there's only like 5 locations on the map, or maybe 6, but they're mostly in Europe and there's one in California right now. But I'm hoping to add Minnesota, get that on the map, and, you know, maybe do some traveling and add a few other places. It's pretty similar. Ready for realities?
Welcome to Realities. Ready to start exploring? Alright, I'll show you the basics. Let's start with rotating the Earth. To rotate the Earth, hold one of your trigger buttons, like this, and move your controller sideways. Try it out now. Nice job. You can also scale the Earth up and down. Just hold both the trigger buttons, like this, and move your controllers apart. Make it bigger and back together to make it small.
Colin, can you walk around the Earth a little bit? So you can see the day side and the night side. Did you shrink it down yet? Can you go both directions?
Perfect. Time to move the Earth. To move the Earth, hold the grip buttons on the side of your controllers, on one of your controllers, and move the controller up, down, towards you, or away, to move the Earth relative to you. Alright, try it out.
Ha 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 ha.
Can you make it a little bigger now?
He's burning. I was going to say, that don't look like it. It's so cloudy.
Okay, now, if you go, do you see a line?
That's South America.
Spin it. Oh, spin it. Shrink it.
Can you move it down? Just move it down. If you're squeezer, move it so you're looking at the top. There you go. There.
Oh, there you go.
In my arms. Much better than what I ate when
Is he stuck in there?
Good food brings good behavior. I don't know if he's right, but
some of the most interesting scenes to look at in these VR spaces are the ones that are actually the most deteriorated because they're just so
completely cut off.
Can he leave that cell or does he stuck in there?
After a while, I start giving names to things in my cell.
Stand up?
Stand up, sir.
From the prison library, and I play a little music. Now I heard about a prison band who practices in the dining room. Hopefully one day I could join them. Hope.
Okay, are you ready to leave
jail? The one thing left, and it's the very thing that they're trying
to
take away
from
us.
You know,
I heard last week,
so now hit the button.
I'm not yours.
Up high? Yeah.
No.
how about you, do you want to leave this and we'll just try one more real quick? I just want to show them, there's a sanatorium in Germany that is very decayed, but it's really interesting to see what happened with that. You're on the south side of it. You might have to stand up. We need to get to Europe. Are you getting tired? Is that why you're down there? Rather than you go to it, you bring it to you. So it's one of those Germany ones. If you stand up, I bet you can see it.
Yeah, I guess.
Okay, so it's the one that's closest to you. That right there. You get the one that's closest to you?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Go here. Whoa.
So the thing that really interested me about this one in particular is you end up going through portals to different locations within the sanatorium, and you pick up all these little pamphlets, and it's guiding you through each room as if you were being given an actual tour.
Wow.
What I really like about it is, you know, what I'm working on right now, what I'm trying to develop is for cyber technologies, which delves into tangential learning. The idea with tangential learning is you, through virtual reality,
so you can see from the photo,
learning
this place has seen better days.
Without even trying to learn. So when I went through this and I started picking these pamphlets up, I got to learn a lot about history and learn a lot about, you know, World War II and what happened just by picking up these pamphlets and just exploring them. And I didn't have to fly out there or spend $1,000 to learn about, you know, this particular bit of history. Can you start picking up some pamphlets that you found? What, can we listen to that first one there? Yeah, go over there.
As you can see from the photo, this place has seen better days. In fact, it used to be a lecture hall for medical students during the Soviet occupation after World War II. The Soviets used the entire sanatorium as a military hospital for their troops during the Cold War. You can still see some of the Cyrillic letters on the big sign down the seating rows covered by the graffiti. However, this wasn't the first time Venus was used as a military hospital. The Soviets conquered it from the Nazis during the last days of the war. And even before that, during World War I, 17,500 wounded soldiers were treated here. Among them was also Venus' most famous patient. A young private from Austria was the patient record 4199. His name? Adolf Hitler.
Okay, so now if you, Colin, if you go to, there's a portal through that door straight ahead. Yeah, go through that portal. So now it's actually loading each room one at a time. See if you can find another little pamphlet.
It's a table.
So it doesn't look like this one is hologrammetry.
As far as I know, all of the ones that we've seen so far in both realities and the lab were done with hologrammetry. So just some still pictures here.
Welcome to the dissection room. Definitely one of the creepy rooms around here. Like the lecture hall before, this room was repurposed by the Soviets during their time here for educating medical students. Both rooms are located in what used to be the laboratory building of the sanatorium. The photo in your hand provides an impression of how it looked here when it was still used as such in the beginning of the 20th century.
Okay, I'm going to shut you down here, Colin. So that particular demo had like 5 or 6 rooms, and when I was done with the experience, I really felt like I had learned something. And the final room, especially, was really neat to see what they had done with graffiti. So people had come in and, you know, just done this beautiful, beautiful artwork, and just out of graffiti in this one room in particular. It was really inspiring. To just experience that and then take the headset off and feel like I had just been to Germany. So that's the kind of thing that I'm really excited to get.
So has this been commercialized at all? Are there any tour groups, any cruise lines that are beginning to...
I don't know. I mean, it's so brand new that, you know, I'm sure someone could make some money off of this, you know, somewhere. Huh? So, you know, maybe now's a good time to jump in on that.
So when you said, you know, you travel to another place to get more stuff on there, what does it take for you to actually create something for your locker?
That is like... You know, you're like a plant. That's like the perfect lead-in to what we're talking about. So what I'm going to go into more details about how you actually create those Phoenix scenes.
I am his friend, but I have no idea.
I didn't set you up to ask that question. So we've gone through these two demos, and then we talk about three and four are basically your two different approaches for creating a 3D world like that. And there's pros and cons for both. So 3D depth mapping is where you rely on different techniques for depth sensors in conjunction with a camera to create these scenes. This first link, which is the more traditional way to do depth sensors with LiDAR scanning. LiDAR scanning uses lasers, and it's tends to be it's more traditional, but it also tends to be a more expensive.
Long-range laser scanning works by sending out a pulsed laser beam of light. The system measures the beam's time of light according to the time it takes for the light to hit a surface and make its return. With two mirrors, the scanner calculates the beam's horizontal and vertical angles, giving accurate X, Y, and Z coordinates. The point is then recorded into a 3D visualization program. All of this happens in seconds.
And cons with this as well, but I think you'll start to see what some of the cons are as I do this. Let's see, one of my cons is happening right now with the cord. I'm going to move quickly with what's happening. It's going from bad to worse. So if I do compute. Now, they've made this really, this used to be, they called it Kinect Fusion, and then later Microsoft built it into their Kinect SDK, and now they've made it as part of 3D Scan and 3D Builder. The whole time when it went from Kinect Fusion to the SDK to 3D Scan and 3D Builder, I've noticed the same problems throughout. The quality has never really gotten better. But what's happened is they've made it easier and easier to use. Hold on, it's loading the file. Okay, so then now we've got the 3D scene. I can move it, I can steer it. So you can see how his face is distorted. So what ends up happening is, the reason that's happening is, it's actually a really good depth sensor and scanner, but it was never designed to be moved around and used as a handheld device. And so it actually loses the ability to track its own orientation and position by itself. It does an okay job, but what I found is whenever I'm using the Kinect sensor to do it, the best chance I have of actually doing it is doing it for a very short period of time. So Colin, can you stay and sit still right there? Maybe do it again.
I do that. So that was, it's almost like the shorter I do it, the better the result is. Because it's the moment that I start moving it. So now if I zoom in, and also since it had less data, it was able to calculate that a lot quicker. Well, maybe not much better, but you can, you can start to see his face a little bit. So yeah, that's sort of the 3D scanning with Kinect. So the advantage it has over LiDAR is instead of thousands of dollars, you're maybe buying a sensor for $100. The downside, of course, is it's doing it this way. It's just not really what this Kinect sensor is meant to do. It was really meant to just stay in one position and then fly to do the desk. So then the third option in the area of 3D scanning is something that is not out yet. But it is kind of exciting what they're doing at MIT. And they're actually doing it with a Kinect sensor. So here you can see, let me see if I can zoom this in a little bit. So you can see this image on the left, that's what the depth is coming in from the Microsoft Kinect. And here they say, you know, this is a laser scanner depth. They're just using that for comparison. And then what you see here in this B is, that's your LiDAR. So here you're comparing Kinect to LiDAR, and you can see LiDAR is much more accurate. But then they're doing something weird over here, which is called polarization enhanced depth. And effectively what they're doing is they're taking this crude image on the left and they're pairing it with kind of a 3D photogrammetry solution where what it's doing is it's taking the camera, but it's looking at the polarized light as it bounces off the object. And as a result of looking at combining both the depth and the polarized light, from the polarized light, they're able to calculate what the actual surface what its angle is at. And so based on that surface angle, at each point, they can then extrapolate, you know, how smooth is the surface. And so they, instead of getting this crude image on the left, they end up with the, you know, just by combining those two techniques, the polarized light plus the depth sensing from the Kinect, they're saying that they can make the 3D imaging 1,000 times better. And by 1,000 times better, they're claiming that it's 1,000 times. So whereas the Kinect has, you know, millimeter level accuracy, where is it sitting here? Somewhere they're talking about that. Somewhere in here they talk about the accuracy. Well, I'm not seeing it, but effectively they're claiming that it's 1,000 times more accurate.
What's the range?
The range is...
Did you do it from 10,000 feet?
Well, for what MIT is doing, they're specifically using the Kinect sensor, and the Kinect sensor has a limited range of, I think it's 20 feet or something like that. And it also has a limited range of being too close, so it has to be a few feet away and then up to 20 feet. Because they need that depth sensor information as well as the polarized information. They probably get the polarized information from a much further distance, but they'd be missing the depth, and they're actually combining both the depth. So I'm excited to see if that actually turns into a real API that we can download and actually, you know, enhance, you know, what we're able to do with the Kinect. Because right now I don't find it very practical or very usable for creating a 3D world.
All right, so
it's
just an algorithm on top of what already does.
It's almost like the additional hardware would be to detect the polarized light, right? So they are combining two techniques effectively in order to get the polarized light. Because this by itself, the Kinect by itself, is not detecting the polarization. It would be sort of like, and I thought about this just today, it would be sort of like how I was saying, you know, the problem with this is it was never meant to be a handheld device, and so when I start moving around, it doesn't work. But if I took something like this and duct tape these two together, this is extremely accurate, being tracked by these sensors, maybe I could come up with a really cool way to actually more accurately scan it. And they did the same thing, but in this case, they just combined it with, you know, some sort of special cores that came out of the particular core. Alright, so I'm back to number four, and we're covering 3D photogrammetry. And you had asked the question about, you know, is that what they're using through all of that? So everything that we've seen in the demos was done with the 3D photogrammetry. I'm actually going to jump to B. I probably should have listed this first because I was surprised by how much was actually out there. So if we looked at the comparison of photogrammetry software, look at all this. I mean, we're just in the A's, B's, and C's here. We're comparing all of this, and clearly you have a lot of options out there. A lot of these options are free options. The first one on the list is that 123D catch, which is done by Autodesk. Autodesk, they're makers of 3D Studio Max and their own layout. So I did do some experimenting with 123D catch, and what I found was there's a little bit of. Most of the calculation is done up on the cloud, you know, sort of like your question about how much is done on the device itself versus done remotely. Most of the computation that it goes through is done, you know, on some server or somewhere on the cloud. But the application itself does have a bit of a rudimentary AI where it's sort of guiding you and telling you based on where you're located, okay, you've now got a good picture at this angle, now take a picture at this angle. And so it's tracking where you are and what your orientation is. And so if I was to take a picture, try to get a 3D version of Colin, I click the button to take a picture here, try to stay perfectly still, and then I move over here, and it would guide me and say, okay, now you're ready to take another picture. And so I would keep doing that and taking pictures as I go around, and I might do it from different angles, and I might come in closer. And then I upload those images to the cloud. But what I was finding was on certain devices, that tracking of recognizing where I am in relation to him was better on certain devices versus others. Like I found on the iPad, it was much more accurate than doing it on the Android phone. So I think what that means is the greater CPU, GPU speed you have on whatever mobile device you're using in order to use 123D catch. It plays an important role. Even though it's not the main role, it is still important. So this talks about how you should go. They have multiple tutorials on how to use it, but this, I thought, was one of the best videos for just kind of explaining the process.
By now, you probably want to create your own 3D models from your photographs. This, of course, is very easy and fun to do and takes very little time at all. Before you jump into your own project, keep in mind, your 123D catch project will benefit from a well-thought-out plan for choosing and shooting your subject. Understanding the general process 123D catch uses to create your models on the cloud is helpful as you start to plan your project. As soon as you upload your images, 123D catch automatically finds and matches common features among all of your photographs in order to create the 3D scene. A well thought out plan will assist in the feature matching process, which will produce a better 3D result. Keep these important guidelines in mind when preparing to shoot your subject. Each of these items should be considered as you choose what subject you would like to shoot and how to shoot it. Before you shoot, plan how you intend to move about your scene and shoot your subject. Keep in mind it is best to shoot your first row of photos sequentially around the subject with the whole subject in frame first, then move in for any detail shots. In general, all your surfaces you want to be modeled should be visible in 3 to 4 photos from varying angles. Plan your shots depending on the subject you want to create a model from, such as an object, person, room, or building. If you are shooting a room, walk around the perimeter of the room, shooting the opposite and adjacent walls, if possible, at regular intervals. Zoom out as far as possible to capture as much of the room with redundancy. If you need to shoot separate shots for the ceiling and floor, make sure the photos have about 50% overlap. Avoid shooting featureless walls, as they will be difficult to solve for. Adding features to a featureless wall is a good idea. To capture multiple rooms, consider each room a separate 1-2-3D cache project and merge them with the 3D modeling software such as Maya or Max. Occlusions occur when there is something between you and your subject. For example, a tree, a light pole, or a car that blocks your view. Some subjects can be self-occluding when they block views of other parts of themselves, for example, a chair. Subjects with minor occlusions, such as these, can be resolved with the right shooting game plan. As you can see here, the electric pole and car have been factored out of this model. The more occlusions that occur on your subject may require you to shoot tighter intervals between your photos. For the Buddha statue, 20-degree intervals around the subject was sufficient to cover all the views of the surface, since there were no occlusions blocking the view. However, for a subject with occlusions or self-occlusions, such as a chair, shoot at tighter intervals around the subject, approximately 5 to 10-degree intervals. Remember, plan your photos wisely, as your project should contain up to around 50 photos and should not exceed 70 photos. Creating features on an otherwise featureless object, such as a white wall or a fabric couch, can be the difference between a fully automated 3D model and a laborious manual stitching process. Use painter's tape or drape cloth on or near your subject to create identifiable features. In some cases where the features are symmetrical, repetitive, or identical, such as a fabric, or the windows of a modern building, the automated stitching process may mistake one part of the subject for another. Keep this in mind when shooting your photos. You should not plan to model transparent, reflective, or glossy subjects. Features on these types of subjects are very difficult to match among your photos as your viewpoint changes around the subject. Even if the photos can be stitched, it is still difficult to solve for a 3D surface. Make sure you do not place your subject on these types of surfaces as well, as the features are very difficult to identify. If you are planning to shoot a human or other living creature, they absolutely cannot move. Also, when shooting an inanimate object, do not attempt to turn the object over to photograph its different surfaces. Remember, features are extracted from the whole photograph, not just your subject. The only thing that should move about the scene is you and your camera. Try to shoot your subject with the same lighting conditions for all photographs. Consistently lit images make for a better feature matching and thus a better and easier 3D model. Overexposed or underexposed images often cause more damage than good for your 3D model. Leave these images out. Do not shoot your subject with a flash. The flash from your camera creates a unique lighting situation with each photograph. So remember to consider these general guidelines from this video when planning what you want to create in 3D from your own photographs in 1-2-3D Catch. In the next video, we will briefly look at some guidelines to consider.
So the main reason I wanted to play that video is they do a really good job of listing, you know, here's what not to do, and so from that you can understand what the cons are of photogrammetry, and I thought that actually, that list that they had there, that they went through, gives you a pretty good list of problems with photogrammetry that are not indefinite, and so that's sort of the...
Does that represent current technology? It seems very, very, very limited.
Yeah, so I, on that big list of photogrammetry, I'd like to say I went through them all and tried them all. I've only tried the one. So I'm still, like, I have big plans of things that I want to do with realities and whatnot, but I am still at my early stages, so I don't really know what I experienced with that particular bit of software was. You're not even really seeing the worst of it. What I found with my first attempt to scan was I tried my 5-year-old son and told him to stay perfectly still, but of course that didn't work so well. It took the pictures, and so I was like, okay, it looks like I'm good, so I went to upload it, and then later it told me with a big error we couldn't do it. So I had to wait a while before it came back and said, can't do it, try it again. So then on my second attempt, I just went with something a little bit smaller and just an inanimate object. I think I was just scanning the headset and the two controllers on the carpeted floor, and I just went in close and did that. And it kept giving me errors about the lighting not being very good, so then I had to fix the lighting. But that was nice because it actually told me that in real time that I was having lighting problems, and I didn't have to realize that. But then I went to upload it, and it went into the state where it uploaded, and then it went and did all the calculations. And then when that was done, it went into this finalizing, and an hour later, you know, it was like, okay, this is taking a really long time. So my experience with it is not that great, but I think part of it is probably just, you know, I'm not doing something right, or maybe I'm taking too many photos, or not enough photos.
I'm thinking about the demos that you did of going into locations and moving around, and those are 3D.
Yeah.
That, I mean, if you were restricted like you were in this, you'd never get that kind of thing.
Yeah, so my hope with using the 1-2-3D catch was that I could piecemeal a scene together. I mean, I got sort of a hint of that in realities when you open up, pick up that pamphlet and you say, we created this scene using drones and we had 350 photographs, so you get a sense of how many photos they used to shoot it, which seemed like, you know, if I did, you know, maybe 6 or 7 different areas using the application, I might be able to get something somewhere, or at least that was my hope, but it might just be I need to move on to a different set of software. Alright, so we are pretty much at the end here. I've just got a couple, one more slide. So our next meeting, like I mentioned, Tony Scudero from NVIDIA will be giving a presentation on VRWorks Audio. That'll be Tuesday, September 20th at the same time. Should be similar, if not the same location, we're in this building. So, any questions?